3 o'clock, so we're thinking.
Welcome everyone to Board Curriculum Committee, and we will begin with public comments. If there are any public comments?
Yeah, I'd like to, very briefly, my name is Nick Prill, and I'm here today because books have come to the attention of the community and the content of those in our school libraries. And I just want to read an excerpt of one of the books that's available to our middle and high school children. In the book, it states, "In Dream World, obviously you can't bang, but you can show someone parts of yourself naked, or your whole self, and touch yourself, or dance around, or smush your crotch on stuff, or do whatever to get someone horny. And then they start smushing themselves around too, and you can give each other a sexy, messy bang dream." So that's what Usher was trying to tell me. Prayer and Grant again were up to. That's what prayers, life and death body, was doing across the skin over on her pillow, and it was pretty terrible to think about. I don't want my kids reading this crap, and I don't think you guys do either. And I don't know why or how it gets on the shelves of our libraries. I understand that as books have been brought to the attention of the board, you guys are working to remove them, but I'd like to look at how did they get there in the first place, and what are we doing to prevent more books like this from getting out there? Because this is just a sample. There's books with pornographic images in them that are on these shelves. So again, I appreciate the reactionary effort, but as a citizen, as a parent of this district, I would really like a response from the board on what is being done to alleviate any of them that we're not catching, because we shouldn't have to, but also what you're doing to prevent any future books from this, like this, from ending up in those libraries. Thank you.
Other comments? Okay, thank you for that. We'll move into updates, and we'll just turn this over to Julie Davis with finances and operational.
Thanks, Seth. So yesterday morning, we held our Board of Finance Committee, and we reviewed monthly financial statements, looking at where we're at for the month of October, and then doing our October actual, this year as well. I provided a brief bond construction update. One new exciting note is that the new office is open at Orchard View. So we relocated that office area. It's now on the end where the media center used to be. So it looks pretty cool. So you'll have to forward on getting over there and seeing that update. And then we had several items. There were action items on our agenda. We looked at our minutes from the October meeting. We also presented, we have Matt Halsfett here from Owen Ames Kimball. We presented our recommendation for the Central Middle Foundation. So we bid that out. That was released in September of 2021, and bids were received on October 12th. We had 21 bid categories, and we received 274 bids, so really good participation. And the total cost, including our contingencies, our fees, our allowances, and our general conditions, is $8,241,563. That will come out of our 2021 capital project. So that's the second series that we issued related to our 2018 bond. And work is scheduled to begin April of 2022, so coming up very, very quickly. And we expect it to be about a 2-year project. And the other thing that we're working on to go along with this is GMB is the architect firm that designed these changes along with this, the principal and other staff, create a brief virtual tour. We've done that now for Orchard View and for Collins and Garnet, but we're looking at doing the same thing for Central Middle. That's when that is ready, we'll make sure we share with you along with the entire community. We'll get that posted on our bond construction website. So pretty cool. All categories were low bidders. We always like to be able to do that, with the exception of our category triangle, which is our communications category. And that was because we elected to go with the alternate, and that communications is related to our P elected to go with a new system, it's the same system that we've been installing at Ocean View, starting up to with this new care box system instead of the old open system as well these days.
What starts first, where it's, since kids are still being classed, where does it start?
So we have four phases of it. So it'll start on one side of the building, so if you kind of walk in, it'll be on one outside, and then it'll flip to another outside. And then there's a phase where it's a lot of cosmetic, so it's flooring and lighting and touching up paint. And then the probably the most extensive phase will be that middle phase down really the heart of the building. So what part of what we'll do is we'll show what that phasing looks like. We'll share that information. Good question. Our second action item was a recommendation to purchase 6 new school buses. So we do this on an annual basis. We try to keep our buses for about 12 years. And so we're recommending 6 new buses for $663,402. That would be through Midwest Transit. And we utilize, as we have in the past, we utilize the Michigan School Business Officials Aggregate School Bus Purchasing Program. So all the bidding's been done for us through that purchasing cooperative. And this too will come out of the 2021 capital projects. And just a couple more action items that we had. A requirement of the board on an annual basis is to authorize a resolution so that we can levy taxes in July. So we levy at least 50% of our taxes in July. So it's a requirement by the end of December each year that the board authorize that resolution. So we'll see that on Monday. And then last but not least, we had a very small refund of property taxes to be in townships, $46.34. $46.34.
Thanks, Julie. Okay, we are going to move down the agenda with a presentation and an update, and then I will give a brief update as to what we've been up to. But I'd like to introduce Christine Galvin and Tamasha to give an update on our MTSS efforts.
I'm
going to
try not to
mess up
this. So thank you so much for the opportunity for allowing us to share how our roles are supporting the work of MTSS. MTSS is a multi-tiered system of support that supports students in 3 specific areas, so academically, behaviorally, and social-emotionally, and truly a collective effort so that students are ensured the growth and success for all students.
In education, we really like to use the pyramid to symbolize the MTSS process, and it used to be RTI. And so what you see over in the corner is kind of our, when people saw a tiered support system, they would see this wonderful triangle which tiered students, saying that we get 80% of our kids should be able to do this, and 15% might need extra support, and then 5% might need intensive support. So that's what the pyramid. We like this graphic now because it's an opened up pyramid is what you're looking at. And it basically shows a continuum of students, all students. And that is from the striving to the accelerated. Because what MTSS proposes is you have to meet kids where they are and move them forward. You have to go forward. And so it's huge. It's a large undertaking, but the system itself, when done well and put in place, meets the needs of all learners, no matter where they walk into the building or where they are now. Hold on, just to make sure that's kind of all those ones. I'll talk about the red thread in a moment. So in terms of meeting all students where they are, we looked at some data I did over from 2015 that I got from Sarah Woodford. 8th and 11th grade for ELA and math. And if you look at us comparison to say, fantastic. We do meet the needs of most learners most of the time. We do that. And so we fare very well on many, many measures. But as we look at MTSS and say to ourselves, well, that's great. Those are nice, chunky, most numbers. You can say, we are meeting the needs of most learners. Those are those numbers per ELA and math on the MCEP or the PSAT. Okay. If we look at what's on the opposite side of that, and we say to ourselves, great, we are meeting the needs of most learners, but what about those who are not yet meeting those needs? MTSS, and what we are here and focused on, is saying, how do we, if we're doing striving to accelerate it, all of those, what are we doing and how do we know who these kids are? Because our mission is all learners, reaching their academic potential and moving everyone forward. Well, those are our numbers currently, and we really want to take a look and a deep dive into who are those children, what can we do, what are we already doing, what are some things we can adjust, because all means all in this district. Go ahead. So, a lot of times we talk about the red thread of equity, or we've begun to do that, certainly in my role, and that is what our students need to be successful. And that doesn't matter where you are on that opened up pyramid, but what do you need to be successful? So this question is that red thread when we're talking about anything academically, social, emotionally, and behaviorally, because kids need different things, and we need to be able to do that. We'd like to really take a look and go deeper into that as this work continues.
All right, so this is kind of a snapshot of October, and I didn't randomly pick October, but I will tell you, in the world of a building, by October, a few things have happened. Transitions from a building, so let's say you're coming from an elementary level building to a middle school building, that transition, you've adjusted to that transitional phase, as well as the honeymoon phase is kind of over at that time by October. And truly, the culture of the building is pretty known perceptually, right? As a student, I know the expectations based on what my peers and my staff has indicated. So if you look at this data, so 2019 was the fall before the shutdown. And pretty typical data. So we have 30 secondary behavioral referrals and 15 elementary behavioral referrals during that time. The next year, as you know, was a very atypical year. And truly our honeymoon phase, and everybody will tell you, behaviorally lasted a lot longer than it ever did. People were very happy to be back in school. And we had hybrid and virtual going on during that time. So that data didn't honestly surprise me. I would have said that probably would have looked like that. And then you have this fall's data, which we have a flop of our elementary and our secondary data. So elementary having 85 reported incidents in October, and secondary buildings having 68 reported incidents in October. And I think this lends itself to two different things. One being PBIS, which is a part of the MTSS system. So PBIS is a positive behavioral interventions and supports. And truly, there's six components to it. One, where you establish what the expectations are in the building. And different areas have different expectations. How I would want you to act in the cafeteria is going to look vastly different than how I want you to act on the bus, right? So you explicitly, this is your second, explicitly teach what those expectations would look like so that you don't have the assumption that all kids know how we want them to behave and we want them to act. And then you monitor those behaviors and you acknowledge them when kids do a really good job of exhibiting those behaviors. And if they struggle, then we redirect and we reteach and we use the sixth part, which is our data, to know how we as staff and as a building need to respond. So if as a building administrator, I look at my data and I see that unstructured times during passing time is when I'm seeing an uptick in behaviors, well then I might ask my teachers to stand out in the hall so that we have extra eyes and extra adults out there. Or if I see that a specific grade level might be struggling on the playground, I might take a time with my counselor to go reteach some specific behaviors for how we play with each other, right? So we can use that data to specifically target what we are hoping to see in kids. The other thing that I think that the data shows is, frankly, we've had 18 months where kids have had limited social interactions. And as a result of this, we're hearing that students are coming to us with less behavior, social skills than they probably had prior. And so we need to be able to give them the learning that falls behind that. So Social emotional competencies are something that our K-6 counselors are really focusing on this year and making sure that students have the opportunity for this learning when it comes to self-awareness, social awareness, self-management, relationship skills, and responsible decision-making, right? So that they have the opportunity to learn these skills and practice these skills. After that time when we had cohorted play-by-play or we had removal of extracurricular activities, they didn't have the traditional ways to do that, and so making sure that we have those opportunities to do that now.
So, this is tough work. Been in education, it is difficult, but we have what we need to do the work, but it's going to take a systems approach, and it's going to take a while, but we can do it. This is a quote by Rod Edmonds, the founder of Effective Schools, and we can do this. We can meet the needs of all learners. It may take us a while, but we're going to get there. Questions from the board?
No, but I gotta say that your evidence you showed there about the number of incidents in the classroom, 100% over the last 3 years, jives with my personal experience inside the classroom as well. Same thing, one district over, same results.
Those numbers weren't just in the classroom, were they? They were
no.
Hallways, playground,
yeah,
halls, lunchroom.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
And that's actually when I say in the classroom, I mean that whole experience.
Within the school.
Okay. Yeah.
just checking, because otherwise, because your students are.
It's been a year.
I guess I have one question. When you opened up the pyramid and it showed people working, you know, like some kids, from your point of view, on the left side of it were, you know, the ones that were struggling up through the ones on the other side that were sort of more advanced, and you need to find the way to make sure everybody's learning. How does that jibe with the data that you show with, you know, like, okay, here are the number of students that are proficient, these are the students that are non-proficient. The non-proficient section, it seems to me, would attack and show you what the numbers are for the tier three on the left, mm-hmm. but it doesn't give you any data for, like, the tier three on the right. Like, how are you assessing, you know, the fact that, yes, the people that are much more advanced are obviously going to be passing your MSTEP classes and stuff like that, but they may not be being challenged. They're not going to necessarily show up in the data as not being challenged. You know, like, they're not going to come up as a red flag. How are you finding that information and addressing that side of the spectrum?
Kristen, just to piggyback a moment on that one, I have to say, I like this. I've never
yeah.
seen this before, and it's refreshing to see, because that concern is all my time and resources really does hit the red triangle. And you know, because the other slips through, it's easy to meet, you know, those proficiencies and then not necessarily know that the enrichment is necessary for many students. But I do know that we do have a gifted program for the 94th percentile, I believe, and above, or something like that.
I'll let someone else speak on that, but thank you for acknowledging that this is not easy when you're trying to meet all the needs
yeah.
of all the learners, which is why it takes a systems approach or in a framework like MTSS. But what I'll say is for our students that lay on what we're looking at, like our MAP data, there's students that kind of lay on 99% or 98%, like that's a flag, right? Or you stay high performing on the MSTEP. So it's we have data that shows the kids that are there that we can use, drilling down and getting those tools to monitor those and support those and those interventions for those students is the work that needs to be done. But we do have some data that can show
that
this kid
sense.
Has been, you know, a 98% for a while on some measures.
Mm-hmm.
Not all there, you're in all those systems, those pieces are not there, but you're exactly right. We have to address all of those children using what we have and going forward and adding more supports.
And so on that topic too, perhaps you can enlighten me on this. I am kind of curious how those students are identified, because oftentimes this information is not shared with the teachers we're working with the students. Is it counselors who know this and are families reached out to? I mean, how does that work anyway?
So we do have testing that is available for these truly gifted children. That happens as early as elementary. And as Tamasha said earlier, there are some tests that just show indicator in terms of, boy, this is something that we need to look at in terms of providing more enrichment type activities for students. Depending on, you know, MAP is one screener that's available. We also have some specific tests that our office gives to sort of tease out, is this a high performing student or is this truly a, you know, gifted? Which are two different things. We have a district full of very, very high achieving students. Either way, we want to be able to provide that tier three. If you're ready for that, you know, the goal is you don't have to be necessarily labeled to take on a challenge, right? So in an ideal world, we're able to meet students where they are. You heard Tomasha and Christine talk about wherever you are is great, and we want to be able to meet you. So whatever it is you need, and interestingly enough, and Kristen, you know, in your experiences, you may have some students that are receiving tier three interventions on the red side, but are also gifted.
Mm-hmm.
So students and children, they don't fit neatly in a box. And you know, certainly not in a color on this. So you have to meet the child where they are, and that's a challenge. And it's something that we're excited to do, and that's really the work of MTSS and trying to figure out where our students, and more importantly, how do we support them? And when you see that behavioral data in there, our kids, that data is telling us something. Our kids are coming to us with some needs, and we're working to address those needs.
Okay, I also, though, I don't know that the root of my question was answered, and that's who is in position to know those things? Because as you mentioned, that particular test, especially when it wasn't offered during times when COVID was interrupting school, or that there are parents who just don't opt not to do it or don't even recognize that it's out there because it's only mentioned a couple times. What, I think it's like kindergarten and fifth or fourth grade are the two times that that's offered. So I was just kind of curious how you identify who is it that is identifying.
So parents sometimes can say, you know, I have a hunch.
Mm-hmm.
So a parent can request that. A teacher can say, you know, have you ever considered? A counselor, really anyone, can initiate that process. Instruction update in terms of here's what we've been up to. We have had what we're calling leveled literacy training. Our instructional coaches have spent some time doing some training with what we call an LLI kit. We use that for that. I left this up here purposely. That's tier two, sort of in the yellow, if you will. And that's for students that might not be experiencing the type of success that we would hope for in that green area, that tier one instruction. In the past, what we have done is we trained paraprofessionals to take over and provide that tier two. What we're looking to do with this new model of coaching that we have, now that we have coaches in every building, is those coaches are now trained, and so we train them. And then we also brought in a small population of teachers just to say, you know, what do you think? Teachers were overly excited about this. Like they were like, oh my gosh, it was like a light bulb went off. Because really what LLI does is it helps assist with that decision-making process in terms of when a child is stuck, when something's getting in the way, whether it be decoding, whatever it might be in reading, LLI provides a pathway. So you recognize here's something that's happening. Now what do I do? What is this real-time decision-making? How do I address this situation? And also, it's strategies, and it's also resources. So now that our coaches are trained in this, what we're hoping to do is to bring in more teachers with this type of training, and we're really excited about that based on the feedback that we had during that training. I don't remember the number of teachers that we had here with us.
We had four teachers join us, but we also have some teachers of an eight elementary, three second grade teachers that are doing it, so some coaches that have pre-trained. But yeah, we have four teachers join us.
It was really positive feedback.
Six.
In addition to that, we're really excited about the GT cluster training that just took place. As everyone knows, we're in a bit of a bind with finding substitute teachers. teachers, that creates, when we pull our teachers out, it creates pressure on the system. Our schools and principals are reporting, you know, either we can't find subs or we have to pull paraprofessionals and put them, if they're certified to sub, in a classroom. That impacts the system because then those tier two, again, looking up here, those students that should be receiving tier two instruction are not getting it because the paraprofessional is subbing for the teacher that we pulled out. It's this big domino effect. So we tried something. We said, you know what? We would like to have this training continue, but we're going to do it after school. And would you come? And I'm happy to say that we had for a two-day training after school. I think the first day we had 25 teachers, and then just yesterday, 27. So the training itself was 2 days, and just had a wonderful turnout. So we're super excited and thankful to our teachers that showed up. And these are teachers that are responsible for taking students this way on this, and so we're really excited about that. And the feedback that Kim and Gabby Kopianakis, one of our instructional coaches, received was really, it was one of gratitude and thank you for making the time so valuable. It was some of the best professional learning that had been done. I think if I'm thinking back to the feedback, it was, you know, you took what we needed, you took our feedback and implemented it. Can't wait for more opportunities like this. So we're really, I think the instruction team is on to something and something really, really good. So really excited about that. Moving on, had some time with high school science, working on articulation documents for parents. We've had some changes in the science curriculum. And we'd like to do a better job of communicating with parents as well as providing pathways. The science, with the advent of the NGSS standards, we did some realigning of the pathway, if you will, forward. And so we want to make sure that we're doing a good job of communicating those messages, not only with our parents, but our counselors as well, so that they have an understanding of, when they're working with parents, what are the pathways that exist? What are the possibilities? So that everyone is aware of what opportunities are here in the district to meet the needs of our various scientists. Media specialist interviews. We just had round two today. So we're excited about that. So we will be, just as a reminder, looking to bring someone in to help with books. And so we are going to bring someone at the district level to assist us with that and look to finish that hiring in the near future. And then the last thing I'd like to report on is just the book review process, which is in place. We are looking at processes that we have in place for classroom read-alouds, classroom book clubs, and then independent choice reading. And that's something that we have been working on. It's complex, it really is. It's a complex topic, but it's something that we know that we need to tackle. We do have a draft that has been circulated, that has been seen. Our administrators have taken a look at that. We have run this through our teachers. All of our secondary ELA departments have had an opportunity to look at it. We're also engaged with other districts in the ISD. We're working collaboratively with, again, our friends at KSD, just because lots of districts are grappling with this topic, and how do you address those concerns when they come up, and what's a reasonable way to take care of concerns that are out there. And so we want to make sure that we're transparent and responsive to both our teachers, our community, and most importantly, our students. So those are things that we are working on. The last group that I'm hopeful that we'll be able to engage before something is put out there is we're looking at engaging a parent group. We've been working with a group of parents and hope to put this document in front of them and collect some feedback from them as well in terms of is there something missing? Is there something more that we could add to this document? So we're excited. That is my report. I'm just wondering if the board has any questions.
training, were they all current cluster teachers, or did we have kind of prospective teachers thinking about
it? They're current cluster teachers, but we did pull the group. And it was interesting because we had some that have been cluster teachers for over 15 years, but we had a handful of first years too. And then we had a group, you know, that had been at it 5 years. So it was quite of a mix.
But they all funded, you said, their classrooms were very valuable. But
it was our goal to offer learning around it, to bring in some current resources that actually Michigan puts out through their Association of Gifted Ed. And then also, we spent the bulk of the time applying learning to things they could take back immediately. So they could go back the very next day if they wanted. You know, we know that some might need a little more processing time, but we wanted it to be relevant so they can use it with their kids the next day. And also use it with all kids. So, you know, we have our identified gifted kids. We have kids that can benefit from these strategies across the board. So that was a message too. Like that these would be good strategies for all kids. And it was great. It was nice. It was fun too, just to be with teachers at the end of the day and have dinner together while we worked, and it was powerful.
Do you have enough teachers currently for the number of GT students that you are seeing?
We do for the cluster teachers. Yes, we have one at each grade level, and you know that's where we'll put the kids in cluster. And if we have enough identified kids, then we might need two at a particular grade level because. You know, we also want our classes to be balanced as well. So we do look at that, but right now we do.
Just curious. I did have a question. Oh, I was just wondering about the timeline. I assume you must have a proposed timeline for the book selection, or the protocols around book selection draft that you're working on. Like, when are you expecting the next step of that process before I'm implementing?
I'd like next week to put that in front of parents as a hope, depending on who we can get here in the building. It's taken a little bit longer just due to the complexity and the sheer number of comments, in terms of here's what I think would make for a process. This was, you know, and we're just working through the logistics of, you know, if there are multiple concerns at one time, what's a reasonable time frame to look at a book or to review a book, and how do you do that? Because one of the things is if we say we're going to do this, then we want to be able to do it the way that we're sort of putting out there. So just working through those is, you know, you want to be thoughtful and intentional, and so we are taking our time to it because we want to get it right.
Are you identifying which parents to run this past?
We have been working with a group of parents probably since at least maybe August. It was a group of parents that brought up a concern at a board meeting last year. And just said, hey, would you be willing to have conversations with us? And they graciously agreed, and we've sort of stuck together ever since.
So curious about that one then. If you have a particular group of parents who are concerned in that way, what about other parents who have different concerns? What other voices are not at that review committee?
Is there a particular group?
No, none at all. I'm just curious, you know, where the committee came from. In fact, I'm pretty certain I know what group that you would even be mentioning because, you know, certainly remember last year. So I was just wondering, you know, how a review committee is put together and what variety of voices might be on a review committee. So,
well, I guess I would say it's more of a random, we could do a random sampling. We have people that we feel as if would represent the community, but if they're, certainly more voices are welcome to look at this. We're not trying to be exclusive in terms of who gets a seat at the table. We're very comfortable with having people look at the process and say, hey, I think you're missing this or you need this. I do see it as a work in progress. Again, something that we want to get it right. That's the most important thing.
Oh yes, of course. Well, and when you say more voices are welcome, but I'm not certain that anyone is aware that it's even an option to be a part of a review for processes like this. But of course, I know you don't want 1,000 people all trying to weigh in on that as well. So just something I was wondering about.
And that is just one group. I mean, that's, we've got a lot of, obviously the teachers who have looked at it, we've got parents who are teachers as well. So I think we're getting a very broad review through administrators, through, you know, this was just one piece of it.
Yeah, and if there's, again, if there's something that's missing, we're very open to taking a look at this and saying, you know, I think you're missing something here, very open to feedback.
And I'll just weigh in on this. And the good news is, as we've sort of flooded areas with thousands, perhaps tens of thousands of more books, so they're available for kids, especially our youngest readers, we're seeing engagement in reading go up. And that's what we want to see. We want to develop a love for reading and have an interest for students and lots of different things to read. And what we also see is an increase, even during a pandemic, in reading achievement, literacy achievement. So we've seen that. I think a growing pain in all of this is that some of the books that we have in are not appropriately placed. And some, and I'd say it's a fraction of less than 1%. We need to review those. And we're talking about tens of millions of pages, as I've kind of done the math on this and looked at this. So having lots of people come in and, you know, many hands make light work, I don't want obscene material. I think there are other ways that we can engage students and cultivate a love of reading. We're not going to catalog every book that exists out there in our district. That's not our purpose. We've got public libraries and other places for that. We want to have books that continue to cultivate and scaffold that love of reading for kids. So, one, all kids learn to read, and then have books where they can read to learn and do more with that. And the learning there aligns with the state standards, and that's what we want to make sure the books are connected to. We can't teach all things under the sun in the 13 years that we've got the kids. That's not our purpose. But it is to provide all students with the building blocks that they can go out after they leave through graduation and learn anything they want, be a self-directed learner. So that's what we're trying to do in that regard. Now, I do think there is a tension point there where some people will look and say, well, I think that book should remain, say, in a media center, and someone else says, no, there's a passage in there that I find objectionable. And I think that tension there is something that a committee and something that a process, and we can look at to work its way through. What I do not want to have is a situation where children are exposed to material that I guess sort of the average person on the street would say, well, wait a second, you didn't inform parents ahead of time about that? Because that may have not been, you know, something that several people would deem as something they wanted their children exposed to. So I think certainly the advent of our media specialists, I think, will make a big difference in helping us navigate through those pieces as well. And I think the process that Scott and the instruction team are working on, we did have a process before when we had the old, and now it's really just updating that and developing new. And the great news is, with all the books that we have around, I see kids reading all the time. my own kids, I've got books from their classroom about tigers, puppies, the cosmos. I'm trying to think of the different texts that I've got there. One is an encyclopedia reference about Pokemon, which I don't understand. The kids have been quizzing me about that. So I see the engagement, and I see kids engage, and that's what we're looking to do. But we want to collaborate and partner with our community and with our parents on this so that there aren't any surprises.
So moving into action items, looking to approve minutes of October 13th, and then to approve the recommendation for the rent collector Cameron Wright. That ends the instruction on this update. Move over to superintendent's update.
Thanks, Scott. Dr. Foster, and I apologize, this might be a little bit repetitive for you, but I'm trying to stay consistent, but we had a good discussion at the finance committee meeting that you were part of. A little bit of an update on the federal COVID relief funds. The federal government is using this acronym of ESSER, E-S-S-E-R, Elementary and Secondary School Emergency Relief Funds on that. Michigan has been sort of paused in the last round, and we think will be the final round of these COVID relief funds, because the federal government said, hey, wait a second, Michigan, your plan to distribute these federal dollars, we've got some concerns about. So the federal government said, we're not going to approve your proposal. And all the 50 states do turn in a proposal to the federal government for how they're going to use these federal funds. And Michigan and a handful of other states, for varying different reasons, they put a pause on it. So we've been sort of, while we know the overall allocation to the state, we just didn't know if Michigan's plan to distribute those funds to individual school districts, if that was going to be approved and when. We've since learned in the last couple of weeks that the federal government did give approval to Michigan's plan to use this third round of funds in a couple of different ways. There's the straight sort of federal formula for the distribution of these funds. And under that formula, there's larger disparities of what each student, or excuse me, what each district would receive in this third round of funding. So for example, Forest Hills was going to receive just a fraction over $2 million in one-time monies to be used by September 30th of 2024. And Grand Rapids Public Schools, with about 40% more students, was going to receive $72 million in the same round. So 2 versus 70, really big discrepancy there. And I think our state legislators looked at that and said, wait a second, is there a way we can smooth out some of those discrepancies and disparities on that? So they came up with this supplemental funding that would still use this third round of federal funds, but they put some of them into a separate line item of the budget. As we look at the State School Aid Act, it's in many different chapters or sections, and this happens to be a new section called Section 11T. And so under that section, we're proposed to receive about $8.5 million in this supplemental fund. That would be our largest, biggest bucket in all of this COVID relief funding. And then we were told, well, wait a second, there's this disagreement between Lansing and Washington, D.C., if this plan is approved or not. And then we just learned that, indeed, they have approved this plan. But it has very tight restrictions, the tightest restrictions. So this is our largest bucket, but it's also the most restrictive bucket. We know the time frame, same time frame. We have until September 30th, 2024 to spend these dollars. Julie's going to jump right in and correct me if I misstate any of these details. And in this case, we have to spend it in certain areas. So we have to spend at least 51.4% has to be dedicated to learning loss. And that makes sense. The pandemic has affected different kids in different ways, and we want to be able to do that to bring up any students that need more time so they can make those academic gains. So that makes sense to me. 10.3% at least must be spent on summer enrichment programs. We know that more time on task is going to help, and where you can find more time is in the summertime for additional structured academic learning. And additionally, at least another 10.3% on after-school programs. There's another time period where we can gain more time to make up more ground academically. So So that's the what it has to be spent on. You'll notice that 51.4, 10.3, and 10.3 don't add up to 100%. And Julie's telling me that the remainder, we can flex between any of those three categories, is that right?
Yeah, we spent, there's a list of about 16 different categories of eligible expenditure type programs.
And again, they're related to mitigating academic losses from the pandemic. Addressing things, so if a student has a lot of anxiety that has come up, that anxiety could get in the way of attending school. That's going to get in the way of learning. So it's dealing with those antecedent issues as well around learning. Now, who is eligible? That's the piece where this gets even a little bit more constrained. We can spend this money on students with disabilities. We can spend this money on students who come from economically disadvantaged backgrounds. We can spend this money on students who are qualified as homeless under the federal definition, and that's a pretty broad definition, I would just say. And we can spend this money on students who are learning English. English is not their first language, but they're learning English on that. There are a few other subgroups, if you will, that we can look at this at. It's a little bit concerning to me. I didn't come up with these rules, but trying to understand them, because I know there are students that may not check any of those boxes, but they still have suffered learning loss, and we want to be able to address them as well. As we look at the other COVID relief fund, that $2 million bucket, there's a possibility to address students with that as well. The other piece is students with disabilities. So we're under almost 50-year-old federal mandate to provide education to students with disabilities. It's under the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act, goes back to the early 70s. And that mandate is an underfunded mandate. The federal government originally said, hey, we're going to require all school districts in the country to provide these educational services to students with disabilities. We'll cover 40% of the cost. Well, they've never come close to covering 40% of the cost, but the mandate remains. The state of Michigan, through various lawsuits and other things, they've increased their funding as part of this mandate because the feds require the state to enforce this mandate. The enforcement mechanism comes through the Michigan Department of Education. So they provide some funding as well. We have some local funding, but even when you add federal, state, and local, it still doesn't cover the costs of meeting the mandate. So we take money out of our general fund to continue to meet that mandate. In this case, we could use some of these federal dollars to cover the unfunded portion of that mandate. And that frees up some of our general fund dollars that could help some of the kids that don't fit in any of these categories that I just talked about, but still have needs related to academic losses and others. And the state of Michigan was very clear in saying, normally you can't do that, call that supplanting. But in this case, they said that's allowable. So do I have all that right, Julie, on that? All right. We have to give an update to the state by December 15th of where we are with our thoughts and plans of how to spend these dollars. Now, we've only been, last week, Scott was in a meeting with the folks from the state getting a finer tuned detail of the rules. So we're still understanding what are the guardrails on where we can spend the money, how we can spend it, who we can spend it on, and the like. And what I would say is that in just about all of these cases, the difference in moving the needle for a child that's maybe behind academically, it doesn't come from a thing, typically. It comes from a person working with that child. One of our challenges is all districts are saying, hey, let's get some more people to help these kids. And that's our challenge of where do we find those people? We can take existing teachers and say, hey, do you want to work later in the day? Some do. Others will say, I'm spent. I don't have more time to do that. Or we can take existing teachers and say, hey, there's more time you can give in the summer, and we'll have a greater group that will do that. So those are all things that we're working our way through on that. And every district really in the country, certainly every district in the state, they're looking at similar strategies on all these pieces as well. when you add up, again, Grand Rapids' total one-time federal dollars for COVID relief, it exceeds $100 million. So they're going to have an outside influence on sort of grabbing personnel and people and a little bit of the stuff. But again, this is more of a people-intensive response. There are pieces in there to make sure that you have continuity of operations, which we don't have big needs in that area. There are some districts where maybe they've got really poor ventilation. So not addressing that may create a situation where we see with some schools, now more in some rural areas, where they're not able to remain open because a lot of their staff are sick or things like that. So we're trying to look, and we think we've got our needs covered in that area, but you'll hear some of those things from other districts, especially districts with maybe older buildings or an even more acute issue with staffing, looking at some of those things as well. This is something that could be related, but it's something that even absent a pandemic, is something that we're looking at. There is a state law that requires us to communicate with students, high school students, what they call it the hot 50 list, I believe is what it is. The hottest 50 jobs in terms of growth of employees in the last economic cycle. And I believe they update this list every 6 months. And what we are looking at is to make sure that our students have that information, that our counselors have that information. But one of the things we've been talking about, and Christine's been taking a deeper dive with all of our guidance and counseling programs and looking at all these pieces, and we've talked with some of our high school principals, well, all of our high school principals on this issue. And one of the things that we want to provide more support for is for students and families to have a better window while they're in high school to understand what are these different jobs, what are these different careers, where do I go if I want additional education and training beyond high school to obtain a job in any one of these careers, where are the institutions, and I use that word institution because it's not always a four-year college. There's a variety of other places, and there are places that are innovating and developing all the time to help meet the needs, and we want more experiences for our students to have hands-on exposure and try some of these things. So it's not just sitting and doing academic work, then going off to some post-secondary institution, spending money, and not really working in any of the fields, and then finding out afterwards, no, I don't really like to do this, and having wasted some time and money. So we want a more robust connection with our employer community to understand what all these emerging needs are, and for kids to understand what do all these jobs look like, and where can I get more information. So we're looking to pilot, and I don't have the title yet, so you just have to forgive me on this, but we're looking to pilot a career counselor to help all of our guidance counselors on that. And we look to have one at each high school, but the pilot will just start with one here second semester, to really beef up that side of the ledger. We don't want kids to just assume that the plan is only one step, and that's to go to an institution after they graduate from high school. And then once they get there, it'll somehow miraculously materialize. Instead, we want to be able to spend more time with kids understanding these various different pathways and various different plans and what it takes to get there. We don't want them to just be limited to explore one thing. They have multiple interests, undoubtedly. We want to give them more exposure. But that takes people networking and connecting with our employers. That takes people networking and connecting with other institutions out there that do provide additional education and training beyond high school. And we need people to do that. Again, our guidance counselors, and I don't have to ask Christine this, but I imagine in your work, you've already seen, they're not sitting around counting paper clips. They're already stretched on this. So this is a piece that we're looking to supplement. So expect to hear more about this as we go forward. I'm shifting gears totally on this next one. So we did receive notice that the Occupational Safety and Health Administration has promulgated a rule that requires employers with more than 100 employees to make sure that employees are either vaccinated, or if they're not vaccinated, that they provide weekly test results for COVID, and that begins in the early part of January when that all kicks in. So we are now looking to see what processes do we need to have in place, what does verification for vaccination look like, what are those elements that we have to go through on that. So Christine and her HR team are working with that to try to figure out what it is that we need to do. We do know just from anecdotal surveying of our staff, you know, that we're over 90% who are already meeting the standard that are vaccinated. But I think really the logistics come in, and there are exemptions there for religious reasons, medical reasons, or no reason. But in that case, you have to submit weekly testing on that. So what do those logistics look like? Those are things that we're all trying to figure out, I guess. So employers all over are trying to work with that and figure out what that is. So we're working on that now. We have to have that all in place by, was it, Christine, January 4th?
Well, we have to have really everything in place by December 5th. They didn't give us a lot of time. The testing requirement goes into effect January 4th.
Okay.
But we have to be collecting the data and have all of those procedures in place by December 5th.
So
yep.
Is Michigan, as I understood it, OSHA's promulgated
yep.
their rules, but
yeah.
Michigan still has to adopt before it would really impact.
My industry, I believe, has already indicated that they are approving the rules as set.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yep. We were also very much looking forward to Major General Mullen visiting us to be at this committee meeting here today, and also at many of our Veterans Day celebrations tomorrow in our schools. Major General Mullen has just recently retired from the United States Marine Corps. He was in charge of all education and training programs for the entire Marine Corps. We have made a connection with him, and I was going to visit him, which was pre-pandemic, I got bumped off of a flight because I'm not a frequent flyer, and some fancier flyer took my seat and said, "How is this possible?" And they said, "Oh, we'll send you on a different plane through Charlotte." Well, I couldn't make the meeting in time at the Pentagon. But General Mullen is a huge proponent. The type of 21st century skills that we are trying to bring into all of our secondary students' learning experiences so that they're really not just sitting and getting, but they're learning through doing. And he is talking about in the Marine Corps how their programs are all aligned so that their Marines take initiative. And they see a problem at the smallest unit level, and they work collaboratively, and they problem solve, and they use critical thinking, and they go and attack that problem. And so he's looking at schools in the K-12 sphere that are giving kids a heads up, or excuse me, a head start on that type of work, and is very interested in programs that we have in the district that's moving in that direction. He's now teaching at, I believe it's Colorado State University, just started doing that. We look to reschedule that visit and have him back. I think it's also great for our kids to see someone in public service and someone who's had a long and distinguished career there all the way through. And certainly the head of education and training for the entire Marine Corps, there's a lot of synergy. Look forward to rescheduling that visit. Too bad he couldn't be with us here this time. Just also related to some of this work, so our program at Northern High School, Project Next, is garnering additional interest. In addition to the Marine Corps, it's garnering interest from a couple of professors in the School of Education and the School of Business and Management at Grand Valley State University. They are looking to do a case study approach, and a case study approach is when they would sit down and really talk to a group of students and their parents about the experiences that they're receiving and firsthand accounts from students and teachers and what the professors can observe in our Project Next program, again, designed to bring about more of these 21st century skills, and interdisciplinary learning where we combine multiple content areas at once. And then also a case study in students who aren't in that program and in our more traditional piece of content. And so they're trying to look to see what can they glean from it. As they approach that research, they don't come into it with automatically a set of assumptions that they're looking to sort of prove. We're trying to see what's going on here. And so they've got a big interest in that. So we are excited about that as well. Again, that would take parent permission and sign off for anyone to be part of that case study group as it goes along. I'm trying to look to see if there's anything else. I don't see that on my list. Scott, anything that I missed? All right. Julie, anything else you can think of? No, Christine? No? All right. And Jared, Aldo?
Christine's?
You know, I am going to present at Monday's board meeting just a continuation of our conversation from last month regarding, we were talking about this at Finance Committee yesterday, just regarding the task force report on 21st century learning and makerspace and the like. I just want to spend a little bit more time talking on that. What are the challenges we're trying to solve? As we take these approaches, what is it we're hearing and seeing from the business and employer community as we bring more of these programs online? What is it that we hear from universities? Because oftentimes the concern as we engage with parents is, this sounds very interesting for my son or daughter, but is it rigorous enough? Will it provide what it is a university might be looking for so they can gain acceptance to the university? So we've been looking into that question quite a bit, talked to a lot of university folks on that as well. And then for our teachers, our teachers didn't design the current system of the Michigan Merit Curriculum. And many teachers will say, it sort of feels like they have a fire hose of standards that they're just pointing at students and we gotta cover all this, we gotta get through all this. I think about Algebra 1. Algebra 1 has 91 content standards in it. So you're covering a new standard every third day. And you're just sort of flying along, if you will, in that program. And what we're looking to do is to bring the relevance into all these pieces of how this connects. And what we know is that we typically don't, in our adult lives, run across simply a pure algebra problem. It is usually in the context of something else that we're working through. So that trying to bring the relevancy to this is an important thing. But teachers will look and say, one, will I be given permission to do that? Two, what happens if I take a different approach and I'm worried I might not have enough time to cover all these standards? Three, where's the support I get to really bring about the instructional modality in the way that we're talking about? Oftentimes, it's our Project Next teachers will talk to us all the time. They're working with teachers who are teaching other disciplines and trying to figure out where they integrate and how they integrate. And that isn't done for teachers ahead of time. So they have got lots of time to figure out, how do I plan for this? When do I do this? Where do we find projects that bring together all these different content areas? Our teachers in these programs have certainly iterated quite a bit and they've made quite a bit of progress, but teachers who are in these programs that might have an interest, these are questions that they have. Who's going to support me? Where do I find the time? are there materials that can support instruction this way and the like? And they don't want to come in and get tripped up, and because they don't want to do anything that's going to create harm for students in that regard as well. So we certainly won't end the conversation, but I just want to advance this a little bit more and get some more dialogue among members of the board of where we are and what those next steps will be.